Hi everyone, very pleased to be here. Flown over from Boston. In fact, we have two speakers from New England in our session today. Very much looking forward to hearing Anjali's session. So I'm based at Berklee College of Music, but I'm not here to talk about that today. I'm talking about my sort of second day job, my freelance work that I undertake as a consultant in music copyright disputes, advising law professionals and artists and music publishers and the like on the level of similarity of two different pieces of music to try and infer the extent of copying. So I'd like to start with a bit of audience participation. We're going to do some live forensic musicology. I'm going to play you two pieces of music, one from 2011 and one from 2015. You may know one or both of them. And I want you to simply listen to the very first thing you hear, one bar of music, and answer the questions that normally come up, answer in your own head the questions that normally come up in a music plagiarism dispute. Has copying taken place? What has been copied? Is this plagiarism? And is it copyright infringement? So here we go. This is Lanterns on the Lake, a song called Gracious Tide, Take Me Home. It's the very first thing you hear is a piano intro. This is Adele with Hello, a different musical key, but otherwise the same.
Hello.
You know how the rest goes, I'm sure. Okay. So let's try it. Let's see what people think, just on a gut reaction to begin with, and then we'll dive into the detail. So who thinks that Hello has copied from Lanterns on the Lake? Show of hands. Yeah, a few, maybe like 25%, 20%. Who thinks that Hello has not copied from Lanterns on the Lake? Is that everybody else? And who's not sure? Hooray for the not sure. So I suggest that this is an example, and I get examples like this all the time. Lots of people say, I think this big artist has stolen my song. And in this particular case, these are generic elements. These are chords of A minor, C, G, and F. With a pulse in 4-4 going da, 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 da. And just briefly, just pull up Spotify very quickly. There's Hello. Here's Nirvana playing the same chords. Blind Melon. Here's One Republic doing the same chords but double time.
Lately I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be.
But they sound more dissimilar than the first two examples I played, and that's simply because the first two examples I played were played on the same instrument. And obviously you can't copyright the idea of playing something on a piano. So one of the roles of the forensic musicologist is to try and get to the core composition and to put that apart from anything that is in the sound recording, the two copyrights in music. We're going to come back to this theme again and again, the idea that there are two copyrights in music, the musical work or the song and the sound recording. They're administrated separately, they're paid separately, and in law they are protected separately. So here's another quick one. I'm going to do this in software. The music readers among us will notice that these are essentially the same piece of music, four chords. And I'm going to play them. They are three pieces of music 2 years apart. The first one is The Redeemer. I'm going to play this to you in Ableton Live in software. Oops. Okay. This is the 2014 track. Play that again for you. Here's a 2016 track. And here's a hit from 2018. This happens to be Ed Sheeran on guitar. Now that third one sounds different from the others, but simply because it's in a different musical key and it's played at a different tempo. Those things really don't matter to copyright, because obviously you can play the same musical work in different keys. So if I, what I would normally do in a case like this is use digital tools to put everything back to the same tempo and the same key, so we can play them back and hear them, hear the similarities and differences. So here's the 2014 track. The 2016 track. And the 2018 track. So the temptation here is to think, well, of course that's copied. So there's two hypotheses here for the forensic musicologist. One is that the people in 2018 and 2016 loved this 2014 riff so much that they copied it and put it into their song. Hypothesis two is that these ideas are so musically generic that anyone could have thought of them. For anyone who knows a little bit about music theory will know that those chords are fairly simple and those rhythms are fairly easy to understand. When I was looking at this case, I looked at the guitar positions used, and they are very much the positions on the fifth and second string that any guitar player would use. If anyone knows the Beatles song Blackbird, it uses all of that guitar technique, sliding up and down the fingerboard in parallel tenths. So in my opinion, and it is just an opinion, this is an example of what copyright law would call independent creation. Three things that sound absolutely identical and yet do not infringe copyright, because they are, if not demonstrably, at least likely independently created from each other. Because the other hypothesis, that these relatively obscure artists were then copied by Ed Sheeran in 2018, especially after all the copyright difficulties he's had in the law courts, that other hypothesis seems to me really implausible with the songwriter's creative process. And we'll come back to that idea. So, musical copying in life, in society, takes a few demonstrable forms, not all of them illegal by any means. We all hear production copying all the time. We hear a TV ad and we think that sounds a bit like my favorite metal band or my favorite reggae artist or whatever it is. And those are just commissioned pieces of music where an ad agency says we want it to sound in the style of a particular artist or genre. Usually they do not use the same melodic notes or any of the same actually harmonic or melodic material, but they copy production elements, the style of recording, the instrumentation, the arrangement and the like. Very, very common, and what we know really as genre in music. The use of commonplace elements, and the Adele example is one of those. Simple chords that everybody uses, very unlikely to be owned as a copyright by one person. Chord sequences. Trap music right now is all over the same chord sequences. Lots of repeated chords that are the same song to song. Now, sampling we know about, which is where you take audio recording from an existing song and then put it into your own song. Often you're making a cultural allusion to the prior work, and that's a very deliberate statement you're making in your music. But often you're transforming that work. You're taking the original, recontextualizing it in order to make a new work, rather than just copying blanket and trying to resell someone else's work. And then melodic copying, I like to categorize it in three parts. Deliberate melodic copying, which is really, really rare, because creatively, why would you? Why would you copy someone else's melody? It's so easy to change a melody in the creative process, so it's dissimilar. Coincidental copying, which we saw, which is the second example we looked at, and cryptomnesiacal. I love this word, cryptomnesia. It was coined at the end of the 19th century. Jung popularized it. It's a psychological term meaning mistaking a memory for a new idea. And it's really common among songwriters. In my research, when I interview songwriters, they say, I've got this great new melody, and their co-writer says, hang on, wasn't that written by whoever it was back in the day? So here, lyric copying, we'll not dwell on that. It's always deliberate. and you don't need to hire a forensic musicologist to figure out if somebody copied a lyric. You just Google it, you know. So lyric copying, when it occurs, is always deliberate, unless you're using a cliche like "Till the End of Time." So here's Ed Sheeran doing what I believe is cryptomnesia. This made it to some legal accusations, but was eventually settled out of court. You're first of all going to hear Matt Cardle singing a song called Amazing, and you're looking at the centerpiece of sheet music.
How did you find me? You came out of nowhere like lightning. It's kind of amazing how you found me through all the noise somehow.
And here's Ed Sheeran doing the same thing in a different key.
So you can keep me inside the pocket of your ripped jeans, holding me closer till our eyes meet. You won't ever be alone. Wait for me to come home.
One music law website that analysed this said, I wouldn't want to be the musicologist that had to defend Sheeran on this one. And I think this is an example of cryptomnesia, which happens. Songwriters report it all the time. I'm sure he thought he'd written an original melody, but he just happened to have heard that hit in the back of his mind. Because otherwise, why would you do it intentionally? Okay. So, forensic musicology, what is the gig? Three services, really. Sample detection, which is a technical gig most of the time. Compositional similarity comparison. So sometimes you'll hire a forensic musicologist to say, did this work infringe this other work or copy from it? Sometimes you'll hire one preemptively to say, will this work be accused of plagiarism? So a lot of my clients are TV ad agencies, and they've commissioned a piece of music to sound like a particular artist, and they want me to check that it doesn't sound like a specific song from that particular artist. And prior works research, because if somebody asserts that someone else has copied their song, then you need to prove that the original song was original in the first place. And because there's been so many thousands, millions of melodies written in human history, often you do find something that was a prior example. And obviously the clients ask for an opinion of the likelihood of copying, and that's a bit of detective work, a bit of knowledge of how songwriters work, a bit of research and a mashup of all these techniques. So a little bit of quite deliberate copying where none of the notes are the same. I'm going to listen to a little bit of Gentle House from 1991. This is the Whistle song. So clearly those pieces of music sound very, very similar. What's interesting about them musically is they use a really specific rhythm. Da, ba-da, 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 ba-da. And here they are compared as music notations. In fact, somebody knows it. I can hear someone whistling it over. I think it was a big Euro hit, maybe. So I don't know which one he was whistling, though. So Love Generation, which is the later track, is in the notation above. Dum, da-dum, dum-dum, da-da-da-da-da-dum. Da-dum, dum, da-da-da-da-da, and the other one, dum, da-dum, etc. Question is, how many other pieces of music are there in the world that use this really specific rhythmic note chain, even though all the pitches are different? Clearly one is an allusion to the other, and that information is not encoded in the score, it's encoded in the fact that it's played on a human whistle. You know, name your top five favorite hits that are played on a human whistle. It's quite a short list, I suggest, for most people. So here they are. This is the 2005 song. And here's the earlier work. Clearly, one is a deliberate copy of the other. If I was up against another musicologist defending this, they would pedantically say, well, none of the notes are the same. because they're technically not, and yet you don't need to do a musical analysis to know that this is clearly a copy of the other. What this demonstrates in the practice of forensic musicology is that literal note-for-note comparisons are not the only tool in the box. Sometimes you have to use common sense and intuition also. And there are rhythmic and melodic elements that are copied there, as we could hear. So the issues. Song and sound recording are separate in law. They are separate in the economics of the music industry. And yet, as listeners, we hear them both simultaneously. US court cases, as we'll probably get into in the discussion, use jury trials, which most of the rest of the world doesn't. And juries are, by definition, randomly selected, so they're often non-musicians. Often they need a lot of guidance from the courts to be able to hear the song and the sound recording separately. And what about where we are now in music creation, where everything comes through a digital audio workstation? That is, pretty much all pop music is written on computers. Does that make producers songwriters? What should be their credits and how should we protect it? But pop music is a constrained art form, as we saw with our early music examples, that some of them were very similar to each other, but they were using simple chords that everybody uses. To me, hanging over this debate is a huge meta question, which is, what is a song? How do we define a song? And I'm going to leave that trailing off with a long echo. Thank you very much.
Well, we're all projecting from Joe's laptop so that the music examples go smoothly. And it's a scary world. It's a scary world out there, in particular in the US, where my co-speakers come from, because the stakes are very high. There are statutory damages, there are jury trials, and if I was a composer, a songwriter, I would look over my shoulder all the time. So what I'm trying to do in my talk today is step back from that and look at the history of copyright law, and particularly how music publishing has been organized, and see whether the world has to be that way. How did we end up in a situation where creative processes take place under fear? It's a bit unpleasant with the echo or interference. Okay. Okay, so copyright law is obviously many years longer than older than 100 years. It was a response to the creation of the printing press, and there are two different mechanisms historically which were used. One was a privilege. Essentially, if you're an author, a creator who has links to the court, you could get a privilege, and the first music privileges come already in 1511. There's an imperial privilege for Arnold Schlick in the Roman Empire in Germany. And we have in parallel a monopolistic control of what is printed and distributed through guilds. So they get a monopoly for all printed materials so that the distribution and creation of printed materials can be controlled. But the first statutory copyright law is the Statute of Anne of 1710. And I put it, some details about it up here. So music doesn't feature in the Statute of Anne. It's for books and other writings. That's the subject matter of copyright law. And it's not really the abstract work, it's an artifact. And that's a very important distinction. So it offers a protection of publishers, of printers against other printers. It's not a protection of a work against all forms of exploitation. And it's, in case law, it's not until the second half of the 18th century that the doctrine was developed that music is a work in the sense of the Statute of Anne in the UK. And what is interesting that in the case, the Bach and Longman case, the judge still held that playing the music was fine. What you couldn't do is make a reprint of the score. So that's really the foundation of music publishing, is protection of a score against reprints. So what is, as a result of that approach, is that 18th century copyright law in practice really was negotiated between publishers. And in regions of the world where jurisdiction was not unified, such as in the German Länder, where we had more than 300 jurisdictions during the 18th century, 300 jurisdictions, you had obviously a no way of controlling this kind of reprinting mechanism. So what's very interesting is that during the next 50 years, the approach to copyright completely changed. So from protecting artifacts against reprinting, we're moving to a situation where we protect abstract works which are identical, to which all forms of exploitation relate. So these forms of exploitation may be public performances, there may be abridgments, there may be arrangements, there may be translations, there may be notes you are just taking of what I'm saying, okay? So what happened during that period is a paradigm change. And I illustrate that here. So we arrived by about 1840 in parallel in Prussia and in the UK at pretty much the same situation. So we arrive at a fairly detailed copyright provisions which derive the term of protection from the life of the author plus, and the exclusive rights include a range of derivative activities. So if we come to the current situation now, when we ask ourselves, you know, is this a derivation of an original song, or should that be an infringement? Those questions were asked exactly at that period of time, because the way the industries were organized had to change as a result of this new conceptual approach. And therefore we can learn a lot about our current situation by looking precisely at that period in time. So how did the cultural production, how did the cultural industries at the time respond to this paradigm change? So this is the equivalent in the UK. I'm sorry that not the whole of the slides appear here. You can see it, okay, that's fine. So there was still an ambiguity about abridgments, about anthologies, about translations, residue of discomfort in the UK. So what I want to show you now is a concrete example of how in the setting of Berlin, because I thought that was fitting, the music publishing industry reacted to this new kind of situation. So we have here the situation where opera was popularized by making arrangement of opera in various forms. The most common one was just have a piano score, so you can, you know, get an impression of what the opera might sound like. But there were countless other arrangements. And one of the key questions was for the publisher, if the publisher published a piano score, if somebody else published another piano score, was that an infringement? And the core issue here is one of the arrangements an infringement of the other arrangements, or do they both relate to this, what I said, the new concept of the abstract work? So at that time, the approach was, unless you copy the arrangement, you haven't made a copy. So that if both are derived from the work, there's no infringement. And there's a similar approach we find in the early copyright law about engravings. So you could take the same engraving from the same picture, but you couldn't re-engrave an engraving, okay? So you could do this, but you couldn't do this. And what's interesting how this is reflected in the aesthetic of the time. So I give you here a quote from E.T.A. Hoffmann, again, because it fits where we are today. So because he used to be a lawyer and a public servant before he became a poet and composer, or in part in parallel, he was asked to give an opinion in one of these cases relating to the Weber operas. And it's a interesting quote. So he says the Viennese score was not a copy of the Berlin score because it was badly done. Okay, so it's, in a way it's different than what we what comes out of our discussion now is that we're looking is, you know, is there transformative use? Is there something new? Is what has been done with it better or different? What Hoffmann says here, if it's bad, you know, it's fine. And in response to that opinion, Schlesinger, the Berlin publisher, changed his strategy. So he then tried to obtain privileges directly from the crown. And the arrangement that was made was that if he specifies all possible uses he wants to make of his arrangements, then he gets exclusive rights for those. But he has to specify them. And if not within a specified period of time, he puts them on the market, everybody can do it. Okay? So this speaks very much to what we, again, will come to is, you know, do we have here a substitution? Do we have a competition between the one arrangement and another arrangement? If there's no competition, it's fine, go for it. And so a fairly complex institutional mechanism has been evolved to deal with this problem, that we suddenly move from artifacts protected against reprints to an abstract work which is protected against all kind of exploitations. So how do we get from there to here? Well, the music publishing industry is doing really well. The annual volume of the industry is 11 billion, and that's separate from the record industry, which is another 17 billion. So it is a big industry, and the fear we have seen, which affects creative production, doesn't seem to translate in negative consequences for the industry, seen as an industry. And one of the things I think we would want to touch on in this discussion, why is that so? And why would the industry not change their practices of requiring licenses for all forms of exploitations in any form to something which is more permissive, and what kind of norms would be appropriate? So 100 years ago, it's only around 1900 really that the music publishers woke up to the potential of having all these derivative rights. Up to then, they were mostly making their money from printing scores and selling scores. So in the 1920s still, most of the British publishers encouraged free performance of musical works so that they could sell more scores, more song sheets. Okay, so there was a campaign by publisher Novello against charging for public performance because it would undermine their main business model, which was selling scores. And it's only when radio came along and gramophone became a big factor that the publisher suddenly saw that they had something to gain from switching to the new model. And that's about, you know, 70 years after the conceptual shift was made within copyright law. At this stage then, publishers thought, you know, much is to be gained from not relying on sales, but on managing rights. So that's the key shift that took place. And once the shift to managing rights had been made, what we've seen over the last 70 years is really a concentration process, that more and more rights sit in fewer and fewer companies. And one of my propositions is that the reason why the music industry is the music publishing industry is not too worried about the situation we find here. You know, the situation that as a creator, you are scared creating. It is because from a situation where you run an oligopoly of the industry, you have more to be gained from operating on the presumption that every single thing has to be licensed. So if you create this space that something doesn't have to be licensed, this would make it easier to enter the market. I think this is quite a complex argument, but I think this sits at the heart of what we, I think, see is an unreasonable situation. We have an unreasonable situation where at music colleges we have to teach students, you know, what they can't do, acquiring legal skills before they acquire creative skills. And I think this is not a sustainable situation. Thank you.
I want to start by saying thank you to the organizers of this conference. It's really been wonderful, and I'm thrilled to be here. I want to talk about race and copyright today. So the name of my presentation is Clear White Lines, Historicizing the Development of Anti-Black Racial Scripts and Copyright. So really what I'm going to do is talk a little bit about a book project that I'm actually finishing right now, and use three examples to really hone in on what we've been talking about today. So the book that I'm working on is called The Color of Creatorship, Intellectual Property, Citizenship, and the Racialization of Knowledge. And though this conference is called 100 Years of Copyright, like a number of speakers before me, I'm going to talk about much more than 100 years to set the stage here. So the central argument that the book makes is that racial inequality is actually a continuing and persistent problem in the context of intellectual property law, and particularly copyright, not simply because of legal happenstance or economic motive or racial accident, but because copyright, patent, and trademark law are fundamentally prefigured in ways that are raced through the ideas of citizenship in particular. And I'm going to focus on the American context today, but I imagine that there are some parallels as well. So I coined the term intellectual property citizenship to describe what Michel Foucault would call a grid of intelligibility that makes it possible to see the racial principles around which familiar and repeated doctrinal standards in copyright, patent, and trademark law are structured. Applied to the theme of the panel, I would argue that we can't understand either plagiarism or appropriation without focusing on race itself, particularly whiteness and the way that whiteness works as property, to echo Cheryl Harris, and its historical development over time. To that end, I've written about the need to bring together critical race theory and intellectual property law in an interdisciplinary framework called critical race IP. And today I want to talk about how the explicit or formal racial limitations on copyright law evolved into colorblind ones through the doctrinal language of true imagination and citizenship. Because Americanness is structured through a racial episteme or a kind of common sense raced way of knowing that a priori constrains the possibilities for treating people of color as full persons, let alone creators, citizenship actually works as a vehicle for importing race into copyright law. And the three examples that I'm going to talk about today actually emphasize anti-blackness, but the book talks about different racial identities as well. So my method involves around tracing what Natalia Molina calls racial scripts, or historically grounded and flexible racial logics that are repeated in order to denigrate people of color. And racial scripts can appear to be colorblind when they invoke the ideals of citizenship, i.e. hard work, merit, ruggedness, and so on. And that becomes a covert means of talking about race. So let me start with the first example. I moved through three eras of copyright, the first being that of the citizen creator. So in 1790, Phyllis Wheatley, the first published black poet in the United States, was put on trial. And she was put on trial by the self-proclaimed most respectable characters in Boston in order to determine whether she had the requisite creativity to have created the poems that she claimed to have written. At this time, only citizens were allowed to register copyrights, and Wheatley was a slave. And while Wheatley was allowed to ultimately publish her poems, Thomas Jefferson, who had never met her before, wrote in Notes on the State of Virginia years later, misery is often the parent of the most affecting touches in poetry. Among the blacks is misery enough, God knows, but not poetry. Love is the peculiar ostrum of the poet. Their love is ardent, but it kindles the senses only, not the imagination. Religion, indeed, has produced a Phyllis Wheatley, but it could not produce a poet. The compositions published under her names are below the dignity of criticism. This language of true imagination that Jefferson uses is obviously a subjective one, and it's one which evolves into a racial script of anti-blackness in the 1800s and 1900s. In cases that I'm not going to talk about today, but cases such as those involving Aunt Jemima, race records in the context of jazz, and even Charlie Chaplin imitators. While I don't talk about those cases here, they all use that explicit racial language in the context of the notion of imagination and imitation to judge people of color as involving or as lacking the kind of creativity that's required for copyright. And that discussion is always couched in terms of the language of Americanness, hard work, innovativeness, ingenuity, and so on. And this is something that will that is a thread that we can draw through from the talks from yesterday. So the next era I want to talk about, jumping forward about 200 years, is that of race, liberalism, and creatorship. So we've heard about hip-hop and rap, but I want to approach them from a slightly different angle to understand how copyright law can seem racially liberal, yet be racially problematic at the same time. So in the 1980s, following in the footsteps of former Motion Picture Association of America President Jack Valenti, the Parents Music Resource Center declared a list of songs the Filthy 15. And while there are originally only two artists of color on that list, Prince and the Mary Jane Girls, the Recording Industry Association of America took up Valenti's self-policing system in the form of warning labels on music. And in 1987, Ice-T's Rhyme Pays was the first rap album with such a sticker. In 1990, NWA was arrested in Detroit for an incident that happened after they played Fuck the Police the same year. And soon after that, the Two Live Crew was tried on obscenity charges. Two Live Crew's defense attorney, who ultimately won the case, said, "This is not violin music, this is not piano music, but this is serious art, even though it may be different." But like Valenti did in the VCR wars, the RIAA and the courts seem to be waging a racial war to protect whiteness, again, as intellectual property this time. So in that context, if we reread the dispute between Bismarcky and Gilbert O'Sullivan, which you'll recall starts with "Thou shalt not steal," the court's determination that Bismarcky was a malicious criminal and Gilbert O'Sullivan was a, quote, credible witness, that demonstrates a couple of things. One is a consistent refusal on the part of the courts to recognize black creatorship as, quote, true imagination, now in the context of the new legal standard of originality. And two, that there is an invocation, a spillover, of fear of crime rhetorics from the time that are related to urbanization. I saw Stuart Hall's Policing the Crisis in the gift shop. This is the same argument that he makes in the context of the UK. So both of these rhetorical moves are moves to protect whiteness, particularly by positing that black artists are the enemy of allegedly race-neutral standards of meritocracy, of hard work, and of innovation. This is how black art and black male bodies in particular become a canvas on which national anxieties about morality, sexuality, crime, and the American dream get played out. And while we might be tempted to read the victories of Two Live Crew and Alice Randall in the literary context as disproving this theory, those are actually exceptions that prove the rule. So in those moments where the courts do protect black artists, it's in the context of a very narrow case-by-case fair use exception that creates what I call parodic exceptionalism. Essentially, black artists have to meet a much higher standard of creativity than white artists do in order to protect their work. So similarly, if we think about the dispute between George Clinton and NWA, that's an interesting one, which sets the stage for my last example, because Clinton did not actually want that lawsuit to happen, but he didn't really have that control over that question. So the same company, Bridgeport Music, as you probably know, sued on behalf of Marvin Gaye's estate in the context of the song Blurred Lines, which is the last example. So the last example I want to turn to is that of post-racial creatorship. Blurred Lines is an interesting case because it gets framed as one in which Thick is stealing from Gay, except that there are black artists on both sides. And various cultural issues here really complicate the case. So I want to make the argument that it's actually a failure of Thick's white masculinity here. The fact that he is so embroiled in a variety of gender disputes in a way that we might characterize using Richard Dyer's term, the bad white, that he becomes a spectacle that overshadows his potential as a romantic author. In short, Thick can't live up to that ideal because of his gender politics. On the other hand, Gay's Gotta Give It Up is also notable as what Gerald Early terms a nostalgic memoir of Motown, a place and sound in which older black and white generations achieved the mythic American dream and appeared to triumph over racism. So there's this kind of sentimentality that's attached to Marvin Gaye's work, who, and we should note that Marvin Gaye doesn't necessarily have better gender politics than Thick does, but there's a kind of sentimentality attached to both the civil rights movement and the place and time that he is playing coming out of Motown that allows him to seem to be a more sympathetic individual in that case. I would also add that Pharrell stands for a genre of authorship that for many Americans still calls upon those fears of crime that are invoked in the earlier cases involving hip hop and rap. So in the end, Marvin Gaye, even though he's associated with a time of national tumult, offered a classic musical style that we could romanticize, that we could think about in this particular context of creative genius. So in this context, romantic creatorship actually prefigures the economic. So oftentimes we want to talk about copyright in terms of the economics of it, but we have to also think about the way the economics are fundamentally prefigured with our conceptions of what it means to be a citizen, what it means to be an American, and what that means in international context as well. So James Boyle and Keith Aoki lay the groundwork for that argument in the context of their comic book, which, if you haven't seen it, is available online. It's really fantastic. Theft, A History of Music. So thinking about blurred lines is not as easy of a thing as sometimes it is portrayed to be in the media. It's actually a really complex negotiation that happens between a number of actors. So black and white publics from the soul and post-soul generations, feminists, often white feminists and anti-racists, white-owned production companies like Bridgeport Music who stand to gain a considerable amount of money from cases coming out the way that they do. And a number of other ideological investments that the public might have. So the case illustrates how the legal system consistently disenfranchises black creators through sentimental divide and conquer politics, through invocations of economic rationality that seem to be race neutral, and also through colorblindness. This case I want to posit is actually a lose-lose situation that involves choosing between Gaye's mass-produced Motown sound, and we could talk about the critiques of Motown and what's good about it and so on, and the questionable feminist politics of Thick and Pharrell's mass-produced pop sound. And that is ultimately both nostalgic, the outcome of the case is both nostalgic and reparative in troubling ways and ways that have a lot of potential. That lose-lose situation that seemingly coincidentally reappears in intellectual property cases involving people of color, I want to argue, is a feature, not a flaw, of the intellectual property system. It's not coincidental that the evolving legal standards seem to always protect whiteness as intellectual property. One of the structural reasons, and I want to end on this note, that I posit for this is actually related to the cartel notion that was mentioned before. So I use this idea of mafia capitalism to think about the ways that a small set of actors essentially produces structures and legal doctrines to protect copyright. So if we think about the who and why of copyright law and where it comes from, what we see is that individual copyright speeches and organizations like the RIAA and MPAA are invested in a certain kind of racial politics as well as a certain kind of economic politics. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Anjali, Martin, and Joe, for your great presentations. There are lots of things coming together here. You've talked about the criteria like within copyright law, and then you talked about the interests that kind of shape and justify copyright law, as well as also how the law is being interpreted and applied. And maybe we just go back to Joe's presentation and the last question, like, what is a song and what can be borrowed, and start you know, again from there. Maybe we can actually go back to the, like, where you ended, then we can kind of get it together at the Blurred Lines case, because this is also the title of the panel. Maybe Joe, you wanna, like, from your perspective, quickly talk about that case, and then from there we can
discussion. As I think I stated at the start, my bias is a musical one. I look at everything just from the perspective of the sound of the track and the notes that can be analysed, because that's often the context in which I engage with these kind of events. So to me, Blurred Lines sent shockwaves through creative communities. We have 4,500 students studying our Bachelor of Music at Berkeley in Boston, and they're nearly all songwriters. And there was a time, well, before Blurred Lines, most songwriters had a kind of an unwritten understanding of where the threshold was for what could be copied, what was appropriation, what was transformative. And put in simple musical terms, don't copy the melody, don't copy the lyric, but anything else is kind of okay. And that's really how genres evolved. And the challenge of Blurred Lines on a specific and musical level is that the melodies are not the same, the lyrics are not the same, but the records do sound the same when you play them back to back. Until Blurred Lines, everybody thought those things were not protected by copyright because, for example, both Got to Give It Up and Blurred Lines have a cowbell in the background, cowbell, rhythmic cowbell. They play different rhythmic parts, but they're the same instrument. Both of them have a male falsetto voice. Both of them have crowd sounds in the background. And what the plaintiff's musicologist argued in that case is that those things in combination are themselves compositional decisions and therefore could be protected by copyright. It does, for me, come back to this distinction between what do we mean by a sound recording and what do we mean by a composition, and where is the dividing line between the two?
I think the evolution of copyright infringement case law, and I think this is a global trend, has gone in the wrong direction by focusing on what has been taken. So the focus, and you say this is always the first, you know, the first question to ask. First, you know, is there a causal connection? You know, and then secondly, you know, what has been taken, but from a creative perspective, you know, you would have to start with the question, what has been done with it? So the incentives at the moment are stacked in a way that sound-alikes are fine. You know, you get very clever people who make something which is, you know, close to copyright infringement, but not, and that's fine. We encourage them to do it. But we don't allow to quote, we don't allow to make overt references, and we don't allow to, you know, transform, essentially. And I think there's some courts who have started to see that there's an issue with the freedom of the arts, and that there may be some more fundamental approaches how you can correct some of these issues, and that we have to treat sound recordings the same way we have to treat musical compositions. Like, they're not different things from a from a creative perspective. If I want to express something in an artistic context, it doesn't make any difference whether it's a sound recording or a composition. I think the Kraftwerk case, which will be discussed, I think, tomorrow, is a good example where in the European context, there will be movement. There will be movement in the right direction. But still, this underlying kind of presumption that, and you say that's what your clients, want of you, this boxes thinking in the wrong direction, and it's hard to get out of that. So if one have, if we start with different set of principles, they would be, as I pointed out in the 19th century, is there substitution? Is there direct economic competition? So that kind of thinking has to come much earlier than right in the end when you think about a fair use defense. And also, are you revealing the sources? So if the incentives are to hide your sources, that's bad. I think in an open society, in an information society, you should reveal your sources. So we should. That would be the second kind of approach I would take. I would shape the law in a way which encourages to reveal your sources rather than hide them.
So it sounds like we're talking about, at a broad level, the difference between what the law is and what the law should be.
Yeah.
And I want to add to that a thread that I think keeps coming up, which is that of the relationship between structures and the production of different kinds of rules. So in this context, and this again calls back to the keynote yesterday, is the question of why should the law be what it is. And so I ask the question of why, because if we think about sampling, if we think about hip hop and rap, a lot of that is a structural outcome of the way that the post-civil rights movement goes, or the post-civil rights era works out in the United States. So when you talk about intentional segregation, when you talk about urban crime, what you're talking about are people with a particular set of creative means of production. And so if that is the case, what does it mean that courts are not willing to consider that? What does it mean that courts are not willing to think about what the availability of resources is to different kinds of individuals? It seems to me to be very different to have someone like Ice-T sampling than it might be to have someone else. I might give the example of the Beastie Boys. They might not be the best example, but we can think about counterexamples along the lines of race, class, even gender potentially, and think about what it means for, say, Robin Thicke to engage in the kind of creative production that he does, and without erasing Pharrell, and then think about that vis-a-vis Motown. So I think there's a lot of structural questions here about what sorts of resources individual artists have, and how that pushes back against certain kinds of structures, and the individuals that have control in those structures. So one of the things that I talk about in the book that I think is really interesting is how hip-hop and rap artists push back against the notion of the mafia and kind of reappropriate that idea of the mafia. So what does that mean if we think about that structurally? And how might we map that on to this song and sound production question that we're talking about?
Yeah, it's interesting that this, I think, I agree with your assertion, Anjali, that people of color are disenfranchised by copyright law mechanisms, but for different reasons. Because I think this is about admin. Essentially, you have a bunch of creators in the music industry. Any pop record has always been a team effort. You always have musicians and producers and songwriters, performers working together to make that collectively created project. Product. And we have chosen, through the early 20th century, mostly through European and US copyright law that began in the early 20th century and was modified in the later 20th century, to reward the owner of the sound recording differently from we reward the owner of the composition. That obviously requires us to define what we mean by composition, hence my obsession with this question of what is a song, what do we mean by a song. I think the challenge is that there are whole genres of music that do not fit into that convenient paradigm of the sheet music's over here and the records over here. That's, it kind of fits Tin Pan Alley, and it fits the first half of the 20th century of the way that we made popular music, that the songwriter would literally write the song onto melody with stave through the music publishing industry, and the artist, usually a separate person, would record it. One of the things I like to do is collect old sheet music, and what I find fascinating is that through the early 20th century, in the very early 20th century sheet music, the songwriter was the photo on the cover of the sheet music. And then as radio came in the 1930s, 1940s, 1950s, you start seeing like Bing Crosby or Doris Day on the cover because they were the person that had the record out. But for purely administrative reasons, well, let's give everyone the benefit of the doubt and assume that it was for purely administrative reasons. The industry needed a mechanism by which you could pay the people who made the sound recording and you could pay the songwriters. And who can disagree that all of those creators should be compensated for their work? Problem is that there are a few genres of music, and perhaps not coincidentally, they are all black genres of music, where that model doesn't fit. The idea of the genius composer puts it down on paper and the recording engineer puts a microphone in front of some performers. So the first example is jazz. So I was talking with some friends over lunch about this. If you're Miles Davis and you do a cover of a Cole Porter song, doesn't matter how awesome your Miles Davis solos are, it's Cole Porter that gets the royalties because that's a cover version, a compulsory license in the music industry. And however creative you are, you're not compensated for that amazing Miles Davis solo. And yet, if you buy a Miles Davis record, you're not buying it because you like Cole Porter. You're buying it because you like Miles Davis. And the second example, and I think it's really important that Anjali brought this up, is hip-hop. Hip-hop is a straight-to-audio recording genre of music. There is no sheet music stage. You don't create pitches in time as part of the creative process. Relatedly, dancehall and rhythms that came out of Jamaica in the 60s. The idea is that you would have the same riff and you would reuse it, and lots of different people would come in and sing over those elements. So the point is that all of these three genres, dancehall, jazz, and hip hop, require you to borrow someone else's work and then transform it in some way. But you do it straight to the audio. There isn't that intermediate sheet music stage, which means administratively, I think the music publisher kind of doesn't have anything to go on. So for me, the answer, and people often say, you know, what should the law be? I really don't know, but the answer lies in reconfiguring the admin.
So I think that's the same point, really. It's not a legal question. You know, the convention that arrangements or improvisations are treated as cover versions with 100% of royalties going to the publisher. That's, you know, it's in fact wrong in law. You know, it's quite clear that you know that there's a independent composition by Miles Davis. Okay, you could argue, you know, they used another composition, but how that is distributed. Is an institutional and organizational arrangement, and what interests me is why do we persist? And I think some of your analysis is very, very pertinent there. You know, why do we persist with this? Which is, you know, there's no basis in law, it produces perverse results. Why do we persist?
So my answer, of course, would be that none of this is coincidental, that sound recordings aren't protected till the 1970s, and that is really, and I think you point this out, that's really about the impetus of who actually already had power before, right? So I think it's about corporate interests. I don't think that's about the interests of artists, at least not white artists at least not artists of color, excuse me. So part of what you're talking about in terms of administration is about structural disenfranchisement. It's about the history of disenfranchising, particularly Black Americans and that them not having access to reading and writing and not being able to record music, record it in writing, right? So if you can't write sheet music, you produce music. But there was very little incentive, and we know this from the history of race records and from the 1920s on, there was very little incentive for protecting that music. And I think what you end up with, and I like this idea of mafia capitalism because I think it gets at this, what you end up with is a concentrated power in the hands of corporations, of musical producers, and so on, but also contractual power. So there's a kind of contractual power that rests with largely white producers and white corporate corporations, I'll say, that we can trace all the way to the present day. So Ravi Sundararajan talks about how the thing about mafia capitalism is that you pay the mafia to be protected from the mafia. And hip-hop is a really interesting example of that, because there's this pushback against what seems to be a centralized set of ownership rules. And what ends up happening is all these licensing requirements that essentially require artists to pay the people that are producing the music. So I think that's not coincidental at all.
There is one potential, in my legal dream world, in my law fantasy, there is one potential answer that I think is available to us. And I'm just going to talk very briefly about compulsory licensing. If anyone in this room wants to do a cover version of, pick a song at random, John Lennon's Imagine, right? You can go home, you can get an Apple Mac and a microphone, and you can put that on top of your piano, and you can make that recording. You can release it on the internet, you can get it on Spotify, and as the owner of the sound recording, you can get a small amount of royalties for that. The publishing royalties will go back to John Lennon as the songwriter, and his publishers. And that's called a compulsory license. My point is, you don't need to ask for John Lennon's publisher's permission to do that. It's a compulsory license. It's in European and US copyright law. So what if there were a compulsory license for samples? What if you could just use anything as audio, and you could just drop it into your track using software like Ableton Live or Pro Tools, Logic Pro, and you could just release it? And we already have sophisticated YouTube algorithms that can detect what is actually in an audio file. And it's not beyond the wit of the maths of the music industry to be able to figure out, okay, you've used 12 seconds of Gilbert O'Sullivan in that track, and therefore his publisher is owed 7.3% of your micropayment royalties. I think there is a potential way through there. What it doesn't solve the problem with jazz, because the idea of a transformative work through improvisation, I don't know how you get to that problem. But the problem of sampling, to me, seems that compulsory licensing would be a step in the right direction.
But you would give an incentive against using samples, isn't it?
Just as there is now, and people still use
exactly.
samples.
Yeah, exactly, and I think that's fundamentally wrong. I mean, if it's used as a reference, why should we deprive our creative expression, you know, from making references to our contemporary culture? I think it's absurd.
Well, which creator do you want to support? Applauders. Because by that example, what about the owner of the original sample? Their work is being re-exploited, and they're not being compensated for that work. So, but there's creators at both ends of the chain. How do we decide whose work has more value?
No, I would completely agree. That's why you need to, you know, if it's an artistic expression, if it's a proper contextualized reference, you know, who are we to judge?
Right.
Who are we to judge? So I think that's the danger. You know, we make as lawyers or as the arbiter of something we shouldn't be. So I think it's the I mean, that was the puzzle in a way I ended on, is, you know, why do we are in a situation where the default is every single link touch of a abstract work needs to be licensed? You know, why are we in this world where we kind of given up on unlicensed use. Why do we need to seek for permission for what we do if we do it in the appropriate cultural context of our disciplines, of our society, of our artistic creation? I think we have moved to a stage, I think to a world where this assumption is shared. And I think it's absurd.
Well, it's a powerful societal and moral argument, but you still have to come down one side or the other on the admin. You know, if a playing of a track through YouTube generates ad revenue, that money's going to go to someone. Mm. And if that track is a mashup of one person's samples and another person's samples, and that's why it has cultural value, then we need to make a societal decision of which creator is rewarded. There's no question that the sample has value, otherwise people wouldn't use it. There's no question that the use is transformative, otherwise it wouldn't be a creative work. So I don't have the answer, I only have the question.
I wouldn't disagree.
I would bring us back to the question of transformativeness, because I actually think it's a really interesting question that ends up being a bit of a double standard. And the pendulum swinging back to accepting sampling or more liberal cases about sampling that we discussed on the first day, I'm going to bracket that for the moment. But when you look at cases like the one involving Two Live Crew, transformativeness is so narrow. The court has a really narrow understanding of what it means to create a new and original expression. And Siva Vedanathan talks about this in the film Copyright Criminals. He essentially says that courts were not interested in thinking about black artists' creative processes. So what is transformativeness? Where does it come from? What does it mean? Those are also really important questions. Because if you ask me, Bismarcky is not doing at all the same thing that Gilbert O'Sullivan is. And I would be very interested to know what the crossover audience is for those two pieces of music, other than copyright scholars, right? I don't think it's very big.
It's a good point. And, that's quite a meta question that I ask myself about blurred lines. It's like, let's say that the jury's verdict was right, just for a moment. I don't take that view myself, but let's say that the jury's verdict was right and Sick and Pharrell copied from Marvin Gaye. Did the sales of Blurred Lines hurt the sales of Marvin Gaye's back catalogue? I suggest they probably didn't. I suggest there's no human alive who thought, now that I've heard Blurred Lines, I'm going to stop buying Marvin Gaye records. Because it's very clearly transformative. So, I'm a bit out of my depth because it's a legal question, not a musical one, but, it seems to me from the economic point of view, who was harmed by Blurred Lines' alleged infringement?
I think it probably helped Marvin Gaye's estate. I think more people are listening to that song than they have in a very long time.
He's got 0.0009 cents from me today because I played it on Spotify.
So I've got another question on that. So a lot of the cases we looked at, one of the big five publishers is the target, and the claimant is an estate, okay? It's not the artist, it's the heirs. So do we have a view on this?
Yeah, just on the technicalities, I assume a lot of people in this room know this, but for most of the world, the life of copyright is the life of the creator plus 70 years, enabling the heirs to inherit the copyrights and profit. So, and it's when you compare that to patent law, where patents expire, is it 15 years, I think? 20 years in patent law. It's much, much shorter. So it's an interesting question, how long should... In our case, in our examples, a musical work survive. There are different points of view on it, which is, the copyright should expire immediately, or after a few months, or after a few years, or never. I don't know.
So I'm very interested in tracing sentimentality and nostalgia as a way that estates tend to win, because I do think that a lot of the times when we talk about music, we're talking about what our emotional attachments are to particular kinds of music. So lots of people have lots of emotional attachments to Motown, and also the kind of music that Marvin Gaye was producing at that moment in the midst of all sorts of rights-related battles in the United States. I think you can't separate those questions from the why and how of who wins those cases. And of course, I would say copyright's too long.
Well, yeah, and given that pretty much Got to Give It Up and the Gilbert O'Sullivan tune, the name of which escapes me for a moment, were basically within 2 or 3 years of each other. And yet, I bet there's a lot more pop music fans in this room that romanticize Marvin Gaye than romanticize Gilbert O'Sullivan, just because he was a mainstream artist. You know, here's an experiment I did actually, just amused me anyway, a bit of trolling of my academic colleagues. I looked at the journal of my field, which is of the Association of the International Association for the Study of Popular Music. And I took three contemporary artists from the 70s, the Sex Pistols, the Carpenters, and the Osmonds, who were all releasing records at about the same time, kind of early, mid-70s. And I counted up the number of records they'd released and the number of column inches written about them by academics. And of course, lots of column inches were written about the Sex Pistols, who only ever released one album, and the Carpenters with their 31 singles, and the Osmonds with their whatever it was, 14 albums, were much less written about. And I think there is this interesting historicity around what we as academics do, and maybe what the market does. I think you're absolutely right. We romanticize cool artists for lots of socio-cultural reasons, and we ignore their cultural importance at the time, perhaps.
Should we take a question from the audience? Does anyone have a question? Yeah, there's one in the back.
Hi, everyone. I feel bad taking the mic when I'm going to have it later, but I was curious because this is all fascinating and really useful to think with, so thank you all. But I was curious about, because this is title of this talk is on musical appropriation and business, everyone is talking from the point of view sort of, you know, there's money being generated and where should it go is one of the sort of presumptions. But really, that when you're talking especially about artists and also when you're talking about race and disenfranchisement, there's actually a question about, is copyright the right tool for fostering sort of economic comfort or beyond economic comfort, right? Access to the means of life. Because especially given the history of it starting as an industrial function, right? You know, what we're talking about sometimes is people's right to be credited or people's right to be known and recognized. And sometimes we're saying, oh, people need to make a living. I'm actually unsure that copyright is well suited to ensure people make a living. And I think we could ask that question about many jobs, right? Are people getting paid enough? Is that really the question? So I'm wondering how much or in what way you think copyright is actually capable of fostering creative practices, or do we have to think about other things like reparations, like just straight up redistributing resources to people who need them, not on the basis of whether their records sell or not, or something like that. I know this has gone quite meta, but I figure big questions, we'll start it off.
I'm on board for all of that. I think there's a lot of people doing really interesting research about what those alternative models might look like. So from Jane Anderson's work about indigenous peoples and licenses to work about Indian artisans and how we might protect local kinds of traditional knowledge. Reparations, I think, are important. I think that's maybe a slightly different conversation than alternatives to copyright, but it's a question that comes up, I think, often when people talk about blurred lines. And when I had this conversation with my class, part of the class was very convinced that this was kind of a reparative, like making up for past injustices moment. I am not against that as a way of evening out the playing field, but one of the things that I think points to what you're saying, that copyright doesn't get the job done, and one of the reasons that I say that the question is not more copyright, but different copyright if we read that case and all of its investments, is that Marvin Gaye's estate gets that money. Nobody else sees that money, right? No other artists see that money. It's not necessarily a precedent for those cases. So I think what we're talking about with copyright is a particularly Euro-American model of understanding knowledge. And I think thinking about all sorts of pushback to that, whether it is in the context of monetary compensation or new systems of knowledge ownership, is really important.
Yeah, I mean, as a lawyer, we obviously in a difficult position there because the international framework is so prescriptive and it's very hard to move out of it. From first principles, the first thing we should do is separate the investor perspective from the creator perspective. And I think, any reasonable academic analysis has held this for a very long time. As an incentive for investing in these kind of products, we don't need more incentives than patent law. I mean, it seems absurd that we need more incentives, to create a song than producing, a new molecule. So I think nobody can disagree with that reasonably. The question is, how do we do this within the framework we've been given? And I think there's probably a justification of rewarding creators, during their lifetime in some ways. And there may be mechanisms by which you can use the international framework, with reverting rights to them or compulsory collective administration. There may be some mechanisms you can devise, to make the system more reasonable within the framework we've been given. But is that how societies change? Do they change by kind of reasonable redesigns by a group of lawyers? I don't think they do. They change because, fundamentally political economy in a society changes, or because, I assume there's disobedience. There are other mechanisms which are more likely to happen. And so I wouldn't want to predict how it's going.
Well, I love how meta the question is, because this speaks right to the heart of how we might define, in the case of what we're talking about today, popular music societally. What I love about popular music, and I've studied it and played it all my adult life, is that it exists entirely within naked capitalism. It is defined. Why are songs 4 minutes long and not 9 minutes long? It's because there's more of a market for 4 minute songs. Why are they 4-4 time and not 7-4 time? Why do they stay in one key? Why do they have repeating choruses and four bar structures and songs about love in the lyric content? It's because this is what the market requires. And in a quasi-Darwinistic way, as I argue in all my academic writings on this, songs that don't meet those thresholds of market standards get filtered out. And over time, that, I suggested evolutionary way, defines what we mean by a popular song. So it's a constrained art form because that's what market forces require. But within those constrained boxes, we have great beauty and great wonderful records that we all love. But while we're just staying with the meta, I love the also the semantics of the term copyright. It's the right to make a copy. What do you do when that Mac sitting up there, the moment I click on Spotify and pull down, or iTunes, and pull down a file from a file server, it explicitly makes a copy on the local hard drive of that machine. Therefore, there is no copyright if everyone owns a copying machine everywhere they go. That's all of our phones, all of our devices, and so on. So, in a way, it started with the end of CDs. When you remove scarcity from the supply chain, or put another way, as a colleague of mine has in the title of his lecture, what do you do when the price of music approaches zero, and then there's no money to, there's no point in monetizing copyright? That's kind of where we are with Spotify and YouTube right now. So, yeah, I think it's an important point. Maybe copyright is the wrong tool in this cross-monetization economy we find ourselves in, when everyone's walking around with a digital copying machine.
I would add just very quickly that we're talking a lot about protectability, but we're not talking about the flip side of that, which is the public domain. So who gets to define the public domain, what's in it, what sorts of things are ripe for taking, and what implications does that have? Because I think that's also the kind of important double mirror question of what we're talking about that suggests that we need something other than copyright, or at least dramatically different standards.
Amend the record for a minute. It's actually a pretty common misperception that copyright is named after the verb to copy, but historically it's actually named after the noun copy, which was the common parlance to describe a piece of printed matter back when the concept of copyright was first termed. And only retroactively have we come to see it as referring to the verb of copying.
That's a really good point, yeah, absolutely. Martin, do you want to?
I think that means.
I guess we can agree whether noun or verb, it's a right. It is somebody's right.
I think we have time for one more question, if there's one.
Shall we hear a bit of Blurred Lines to finish then?
seems entirely appropriate.
Can't bear the idea of not talking about a piece of music and not playing it. It feels all wrong. So I think everyone here knows the background, but just for those who don't, 1977 got To Give It Up, the Marvin Gaye tune, Blurred Lines 2013. The jury in the initial case, I think 2014, found copying and substantial similarity. And let's listen to... This is the sheet music that appeared, was filed with the US Copyright Office. This is a transcription, and it was done after the fact. So this is not Marvin Gaye's handwriting. This is a junior transcriber from the US Copyright Office. And so what you are going to see as you hear the track is those first two lines of music that I hope you can make out, which is the bass line, and then you're going to hear the falsetto melody. And as you hear it, try and get that melody in your head and then decide how much of it you think Robin Thicke has copied. There's the party noises. Listen to that cowbell. Okay, take it away, Robin.
Everybody get up.
This song has more cowbells. To parties and sit the center, but I was too nervous.